Hi, it's Michelle of Lab Muffin Beauty Science, chemistry, PhD, and cosmetic chemist, and today we're going to go through my teenage skincare routine. Yes, a lot of the products were horrifying. If you like nerding out about the science behind beauty products, click like, subscribe, and the notification bell. I'm turning 35 this year, which means I grew up in the 2000s. The 2000s were a time of Britney, flared jeans, butterfly clips, and some really cringy skincare. Despite some really cringe moments, I think overall, in hindsight, it was actually quite a nice time. You had a bit more breathing room between apocalyptic events. So here is what I look like in the 2000s. I went through a lot of regrettable years when I didn't have a fringe. I sort of was channeling the middle-aged accountant vibe. You can also tell it was like the height of my trichotillomania. I was doing a lot of hair pulling and you can see the hair regrowth is a bit warped. So what skincare was teenage Michelle using? Firstly, I was using the Avon Invigorating Scrub. My dad bought this when I started getting pimples and it's kind of exactly what you'd expect a clueless dad to buy. This was bright blue. It had scrubbing particles in it, which were shaped like shards, like they were literally triangles. It was mentholated to death. And yeah, it was fresh to death. It felt like you were sandpapering your face and then dunking your face in a bucket of ice water. And this was kind of what we assumed acne care should have been at the time. This was before the gospel of Paula, of Paula's choice, our Lord and Savior, really took hold. This was even before Google took hold. We were searching things on like Yahoo Search, Alta Vista, and Ask Jeeves. We weren't going to find Paula. I'm pretty confident this was way worse than St. Ives Apricot Scrub. To no one's surprise, my skin did not like this. I actually remember the skin on my nose going hard and stiff and cracking, and I remember trying to peel off the flakes with a pair of tweezers, and that was not good. I ended up with just a constantly scabby nose. This was dehydrating as hell, and I have dehydration-prone skin. So yeah, this was not a happy time. You cannot successfully treat acne by just scrubbing it and drying it out. Harsh treatments will usually just make acne worse because one of the contributing factors to acne is inflammation. Now, the next step in my teenage skincare journey was Clean & Clear's 3-step oil control pack. At the time, Clean & Clear had this massive campaign that was targeting teenagers. They would stick these little sample bottle packs to the front of teenage music magazines. I got a bunch of different sets from this magazine I used to buy called TV Hits, and I actually remember buying this exact one. It had 5 on the cover. My best friend at the time was obsessed with this boy band 5, and she made me give her the centerfold. We're not friends anymore for unrelated reasons. So looking this up based on the ingredients, it looks like the exact same formulas as I was using 20 years ago are still available now. The packaging is exactly the same. It doesn't look like they're sold in the US or the UK anymore. Maybe they're just shunting the leftovers to us Australians because no one cares about us. Okay, the cleanser. This ingredient list looks nothing like anything else I've seen in a really long time. I think the way it's working is they've got free fatty acids and triethanolamine, which is a base, and by mixing that together, they basically make soap. I remember this being really foamy, and for these soap surfactants to foam well, it'd have to be somewhere near pH 8 or 9. It also has methyl isothiazolinone as a preservative. This is MI, and it's a pretty common allergen. It's only allowed in wash-off products these days, and you don't really see it in face products that much anymore. It is reasonably common in shampoos and conditioners. My skin is generally pretty robust, but this particular ingredient and its cousin, MCI, both make me really itchy. And I wonder if I was actually allergic to this product at the time and I just didn't know. I do remember this being pretty stripping, and we all thought back then that stripping is good, tight means clean, and a lot of people still think this. It's not true. If you feel tight after cleansing, usually this means that the proteins in your skin have changed their shape. They're denatured, and since these proteins are an essential part of your skin barrier, that means that your skin barrier is probably leaky. It's losing water and it's letting irritants in. Now, the toner. This was a really blue alcoholic toner. This is basically Paula's nightmare toner. These days, toners are a lot better. They're not just dehydrating alcohol-laden products anymore, except apparently this one. It's a pretty simple formula. It's got alcohol and salicylic acid. It's also got glycerin 26, which is emollient. It's sort of like a less effective version of glycerin. It's also got allantoin and panthenol, which are soothing and moisturizing ingredients, which I don't know if they're going to help given everything else in this formula. This was super watery, so you had to apply it with a cotton ball, and I remember it stung so much, and the assumption was if it hurts, it works. Now the moisturizer, this ingredient list actually looks pretty similar to a lot of moisturizers that we have on the market now, and it's actually kind of nice seeing all those parabens in there. I remember this being fine. I remember I didn't really use it that much because I had oily skin and acne, and the myth is if you have oily skin and acne, you don't need a moisturizer. I need a moisturizer. I wonder if I would have had an easier time getting into skincare if this had glycerin in it. It does have propylene glycol as the second ingredient. This is a humectant, but it's nowhere near as hydrating as glycerin. My skin is really dehydration prone, and yeah, this moisturizer did not convince me that my skin needed moisturizer. If I was redesigning this moisturizer, I'd replace the propylene glycol with glycerin, and I would add sun protection to this. I think it doesn't have sun protection because it has 0.5% salicylic acid, and in the US that would make it a drug. And I don't think you're allowed to have sunscreen and salicylic acid in the one product. We already have salicylic acid in the toner anyway, so I think getting rid of that and putting in sun protection would be really good as an introduction to teenage skincare. I also use Clean and Clear blotting papers, and these were also attached to the front of a magazine. These actually look pretty much the same as the ones I used when I was a teenager. I don't think they've really changed these. And yeah, I think that's actually because they were pretty good. They're these light blue sheets that you press down on your face, they soak up oil, and you can see the blue plastic go clear. It's very satisfying. It's a nice way of getting rid of excess oil without irritating your skin. These are made of plastic though, and these days I use paper ones that I get from an Asian supermarket, and they seem to soak up more oil as well as being a bit more environmentally friendly. The next step up was when I actually bought my own products instead of getting them off the front of a magazine. I was using Cetaphil Gentle Skin Cleanser and Nivea Visage Cleansing Gel. I think these two products are where I got my hate of cleansing over the sink from. The Cetaphil was a gel product that didn't foam, so this one you could either put it on your face and wash it off, or you could actually put it on your face and then wipe it off with a damp cloth. Since my skin was oily, I kind of felt like this just didn't do much, and I don't remember using it more than a couple times. I do remember the bottle sitting in my bathroom for years. So I think really the problem here was that this just didn't match my skin type. Now, the Nivea Cleansing Gel. Some not very well formulated cleansers do this thing where they stick onto your hand and they don't really foam up. So you'll put it in your hand, you'll try to foam it up, you'll wash your face, you'll rinse off your face, and then after all of that, you'll still have like a dollop of gel stuck to the middle of your hand. Even these days, there are a few cleansers I've used that still do this. One is the Inky Salicylic Acid Cleanser. I don't know why I kept on buying this, even though it was such a pain to use. I think it might have just been the cheapest cleanser from the supermarket. But this was actually quite hydrating. It didn't strip my skin. It was just a little bit annoying to use. So onto the product that every teenager ends up using, benzoyl peroxide. My first benzoyl peroxide product was Benzac 10% cream because I decided to be a cheap ass, and I saw all this stuff online about how you should be using 2.5%, but I figured 10% divided by 4, if I just dilute that, I will end up with 2.5%. Of course, the first day I got lazy and instead of diluting it, I just sort of went, I'll just put less on my face. And I put it all over my face. I went to uni and then in the middle of the day, someone was like, Michelle, are you sunburnt? So basically the benzoyl peroxide was really irritating and I think it made my skin also sensitive to the sun. And so I just sort of had this beet red face that just started in the middle of the day. To make things worse, Benzac also has micro sponge technology, so it's got like little white bits in it, and I had tiny little white flecks all over my face as well. It was a disaster. So after trying to make that work for a few days, I think I abandoned it and I just went off and ordered 2.5% benzoyl peroxide from acne.org. Acne.org is a website started by a guy who had bad acne. And he made his own products because he just found them so difficult to find. And 2.5% benzoyl peroxide is like the cornerstone product. So his version was really good. It was pretty cheap. It had a decent texture. And the only problem was that it took a while to ship to me, which was why I started with the Benzac. This worked quite well, but it did sort of dry the crap out of my face. Benzoyl peroxide is really good at reacting with dyes and breaking them up, and that causes things to bleach. These days, there are lots of benzoyl peroxide washes available, and I would go with one of them instead because you can wash it off, and so less of it ends up on your towels and on your clothes and on your pillowcase. So that takes me to uni and the end of my teenage years. I still hadn't worked out a skincare routine by that point. And honestly, I didn't really get anywhere with my skincare until I was around 21 or 22. And even then, it took me a few years to get the hang of how to give myself a skincare routine. So it took me till my mid to late 20s to really understand my skin and be able to predict which products would actually work well for it. My excuse is that we didn't really have the resources that we do now. We didn't have skincare on YouTube. The only place you could really find good information was the Paula's Choice website. Also noticed the distinct lack of sunscreen in my routine. I didn't really start trying to wear it till my mid-20s, and even then it took me a few years to get consistent with wearing it every day. So I hope you enjoyed this throwback episode. Let me know if you recognize any of these products or if you use them. And if not, what were the iconic products that you used in your teenage years? I'm going to post the routine that I wish I had when I was a teenager soon, so subscribe and click the notification bell for that. You can also follow me on Instagram and TikTok and check out my blog for more. See you next time for more science.